Schön, dass Sie alle, dass ihr alle hier seid. Wir freuen uns auf spannende Debatten mit Ihnen und euch. Ich begrüße Sara Farris nochmal, die heute schon im Rahmen eines ersten Workshop-Tages bei uns war und auch schon einen Vortrag gehalten hat, aber nicht zum Thema von heute Abend. Das Thema von heute Abend wird sein The Political Economy of Femonationalism. Und was das ist, wird sie nachher noch erklären. Welcome, Sara. Mein Name ist Katharina Pühl. Ich arbeite als Referentin für feministische Gesellschafts- und Kapitalismusanalyse hier an der Stiftung und freue mich, dass ich das heute Abend moderieren darf. Ja, der Themenzusammenhang der Lecture ist nicht nur der des Workshops zur Emanzipation heute hier im Haus, sondern natürlich auch der rechtsradikaler Entwicklungen und Anti-Gender-Politiken. Wir haben ein buntes Jahr hinter uns mit dem Start Silvester in Köln und es ordnet sich sozusagen ein in verschiedene Themenbezüge der Arbeit hier an der Stiftung zu politischer Ökonomie, zu Gender-Fragen und aber natürlich auch zur Frage der Verschränkung von Sexismus, Rassismus und Antimuslimismus in unserem Falle heute. Genau, der Vortrag wird ungefähr 45 Minuten dauern, schätzt Sara. Dann darf ich jetzt Sara vorstellen. Sie arbeitet als Senior Lecturer am Goldsmith College in London an der Universität und hat vielfältig im Feld von Migrationsstudien aus soziologischer Sicht, aber auch aus Sicht der politischen Ökonomie und der Gender Studies gearbeitet, also ein breites Feld von Expertise und Arbeitsgebieten. Und um mit dem aktuellsten anzufangen, forthcoming, im Erscheinen ist ein Buch, das heißt The Rise of Femonationalism, also zum Thema des Abends, das aber noch im Druck ist. Sie hat sich aber auch schon länger mit dem Thema Orientalismus beschäftigt, zum Beispiel auch in Auseinandersetzung mit Max Weber. Dazu gibt es auch ein Buch von ihr von 2013. Ansonsten auch zahlreiche Aufsätze. Wer das haben will, kann sich auch gerne noch mal per E-Mail an mich wenden. Ich kann auch Sachen noch mal vorwarten, wenn ihr Interesse habt. Damit würde ich sagen, du hast the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me with... Okay. So, first of all, thanks a lot for this invitation. It's quite interesting to be here presenting this work, as I said, the week that Angela Merkel says she wants to ban the veil of Muslim women. So, as you will see, I will be speaking not about Angela Merkel, but about these issues. So I hope really we will have a discussion and we'll have the opportunity to open really a conversation on all of this. So what I'm going to do today, I will stick to this paper, which hopefully will allow me to stay within the 45 minutes, so 50 maximum, as I promised. But just to give you a little introduction, this really is very largely based on my forthcoming book, which will come out next year in April in English, and it's called In the Name of Women's Rights, The Rise of Femonationalism. So today I will be presenting some of the arguments that are present in this book. The success of the far right in important elections in recent years has attracted a great deal of international attention. From the European elections in 2014 to more recent local elections in France, Germany, and the Netherlands, right-wing parties like the National Front or Alternative für Deutschland or the Party for Freedom are clearly on the rise. These electoral achievements, coupled with the harshness of the anti-immigration slogans that characterize these parties' campaigns, have triggered fears of a return of fascism. Yet, one of the striking features distinguishing contemporary European nationalist parties from their older counterparts is the invocation of gender equality and occasionally in some parties also LGBT rights within an otherwise xenophobic rhetoric. So here I'm just showing you a slide. This is from the Northern League, which is an Italian far-right party. And this is a poster from 2006. It's just quite explicative, that's why I chose it, because in this poster they are against the entrance of Turkey into the European Union when there were discussions about this possibility. And in this poster, which is incredibly clear, they say, okay, them, us, are we willing to take the risk, not to Turkey in Europe? Meaning, obviously, that to allow the entrance of a country with a Muslim majority would mean that all women, all the European, Italian women, or European women will be forced to be like in a cage and with a veil like Muslim women. So again, this is just to give you an example of how these parties that don't really care about gender equality nonetheless are exploiting these issues of gender equality in anti-immigration and especially in anti-Islam agendas. The other example is Marine Le Pen. Marine Le Pen in 2012, and this is just one of the statements that she made, said that there is no sexism in French schools. If you want to find sexism, you need to go to the banlieue. The girls in the banlieue that are the neighborhoods with high percentages of immigrants, and especially Arab Muslims, cannot wear short skirts. The girls in the banlieue are treated like objects. So these are just two examples. So despite the lack of concern with elaborating concrete policies of gender equality and their masculinist political style, these parties have increasingly advanced their anti-Islam agendas in the name of women's rights. From Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, who also uses a very similar type of feminist lexicon or gender equality lexicon to attack Muslims, to Marine Le Pen, Matteo Salvini in Italy, that are also the key animators of what it's called the Brown International. One of the central tropes mobilized by these right-wing nationalists is the profound danger Muslim males constitute for Western European societies, due above all to their oppressive treatment of women. And yet, right-wing nationalists are not the only forces waving the banner of women's equality in ways that seem to contradict their core ideologies and policies. On the other side of the political spectrum, some well-known and outspoken feminists have also joined at the anti-Islam choir. In this slide, you see Elisabeth Badinter, who is a very important feminist, French feminist philosopher. And I just transcribed the words of an audition that she had, in which she was asked, why should France ban the burqa from public spaces? So it was an audition in 2010. And she says, I'm not going to read the whole quote because it's quite long, but I think we are dealing with very sick women, referring to Muslim women who wear a full veil, and I do not think that we have to be determined according to their pathology. So three very different political actors, these right-wing nationalists and certain feminists, are invoking women's rights to stigmatizing Muslim men in order to advance their own political objectives. But why are these different movements invoking this trope, is invoking the same trope of gender equality and identifying Muslim men as one of the most dangerous threats to Western societies? Are we witnessing the rise of a new unholy alliance, or is this seeming consensus across the political spectrum merely coincidental and contingent? And finally, why are Muslim women being presented with offers of emancipation and rescue in a context of rising Islamophobia and anti-immigration sentiments, particularly regarding employment and welfare? As I discuss in the following sections, various scholars have explained the new centrality of gender and sometimes gay equality within anti-Islam agendas as a consequence of the shift to the right and the war on terror that marked the 2000s in Europe and the US, particularly after 9/11. They thus emphasize the securitarian logic of the contemporary rescue narratives targeting Muslim women as victims, and read these narratives mainly as a political constellation that characterized the current neoliberal and nationalist zeitgeist. So there is a large field of scholarship. Various authors have tried to understand what's going on. Why are these parties endorsing gender equality against Muslims, and why are feminists also endorsing anti-Islam stances in the name of women's rights? So I would like to argue that instead in important political economic dimensions that underlie these paradoxical intersections in Western Europe have for the most part been overlooked. The majority of scholars really focus on these political constellations, but in my view, they don't pay enough attention also to the political economy of this phenomenon. Furthermore, I claim that the ways in which anti-Islam campaigns in the name of gender equality feed on and shape broader anti-immigration and racist ideologies and institutions have not received the sustained attention they deserve. In this talk, which draws on a forthcoming book, which is the one I mentioned before, I intend to propose some new links, conceptualizations, and categories of analysis to decipher the reasons for the surprising intersection among nationalists, feminists, and neoliberals. In order to name this intersection and frame the political economic logic underpinning it, I have coined the term femonationalism. So femonationalism, which is short for feminist and femocratic nationalism, refers both to the exploitation of feminist themes by nationalists and neoliberals in anti-Islam, but as I will show also in anti-immigration campaigns, and to the participation of certain feminists and femocrats in the stigmatization of Muslim men under the banner of gender equality. Femonationalism thus describes, on the one hand, the attempts of Western European right-wing parties and neoliberals to advance xenophobic and racist politics through the touting of gender equality, while on the other hand, it captures the involvement of various well-known and quite visible feminists and femocrats in the current framing of Islam as a quintessentially misogynistic religion and culture. In order to define and map out femonationalism, I should say from the outset, I focus on three countries, Italy, France, and the Netherlands. And in these countries, I focus upon specific right-wing parties, the Northern League in Italy, the Party for Freedom in the Netherlands, and the National Front in France. I say this because obviously many of the things that I will be saying today are very much based upon an analysis of this country specifically, so I'm not claiming that this can be generalized across Europe, and I'm not even sure that they necessarily reflect the situation you have in Germany, for example. But I wonder, it would be interesting to see also from the conversation if you think that there are similarities and think that can be it can help also to understand some of the features of contemporary anti-Islam rhetoric in Germany. So to anticipate a bit, in this talk I want to suggest that femonationalism must be understood as an ideology that springs from a specific mode of encounter, or what I prefer to call a convergence, amongst the different political projects, and that is produced by and productive of a specifically economic logic. So the next parts of this paper will be devoted really to clarify these three key theoretical dimensions of femonationalism, what I call femonationalism as a convergence, as an ideological formation, and as a neoliberal political economy. So in this first part, I will try to explain why I think femonationalism is a convergence. There is a large body of critical literature documenting the paradoxical endorsement of women's and LGBT rights by right-wing and traditionally anti-feminist, homophobic parties and neoliberals, as well as the support in recent years by some feminists and queers of Islamophobic agendas. Scholars have used two main approaches to explain the type of encounter between nationalism or feminist and queer movements and neoliberalism. In fact, maybe I should just make a very brief note, some of these parties are not just exploiting gender equality against Muslims, they're also more and more resorting to ideas of LGBT rights. In a country like France, for instance, Marine Le Pen and the National Front that were historically absolutely homophobic and they would never resort to ideas of LGBT rights, Marine Le Pen has been very very silent on this topic. And in some occasions, she has also actually said that one of the problems with Muslim communities is that they are homophobic. And more in France, there are quite well-known queer or homosexual men, well-known men, models, actors, etc., who are openly supporting the National Front. This is not happening everywhere, but certainly in the case of Geert Wilders, and in the Netherlands, Muslims have been very much attacked, both in the name of women's rights, but also in the name of gays and homosexuals' rights. So because of these exploitations, scholars have, in fact, referred to this encounter between anti-Islam politics and issues of gender equality or LGBT rights in terms of instrumentalization or indeed exploitation. So this approach has been put forward, for instance, by French sociologist Henrique Fassin, who talks about sexual nationalism in the French context and talks explicitly about the ways in which the National Party instrumentalizes gender equality for Islamophobic purposes. Or Liz Fekete, in the British context, speaks in what she calls enlightened fundamentalism. And within this work, she thinks that these parties, these right-wing parties across Europe, are exploiting issues of gender equality. So we have, on the one hand, scholars who talk of exploitation and instrumentalization. On the other hand, other scholars use the notions of collusion or alliance. And here I'm thinking especially of the work of Jasbir Puar. Maybe some of you know her. She introduced this notion of homonationalism, which obviously inspired also my notion, as you can tell. Within this notion, she foregrounds the ways in which gay rights have been mobilized against Muslims and racialized others within new heteronormative frameworks. But she talks of a collusion. She thinks that there are some sections of the LGBT movement in the United States that are openly colluding and explicitly colluding with certain American anti-Islam nationalism. So they are two quite different perspectives in a way. I try to propose another concept to understand what's going on between these feminists, some neoliberals and right-wing parties, all coming together in the name of women's rights. So by proposing to understand femonationalism as the outcome of a convergence instead of instrumentalization or collusion, I don't want really to reject this analysis. I'm not saying that my concept is better than this. I am trying instead to say and to argue that this notion enables us to ask two important questions when we look at the Dutch, French, and the Italian nationalist right parties, the neoliberals and this composite feminist and femocratic camp that I explore. First, I think that the notion of convergence allows us to ask what are the ideological matrices that have encouraged these parties, actors, and movements that are very, very different between each other to advance anti-Islam and anti-immigration politics in the name of women's rights, in spite of the significant differences among them. So in a way, I think the notion of instrumentalization in a way makes the feminist too passive. There is an idea in which the feminists against Islam are not very much part of these forms of anti-Islam rhetoric, whereas I think that many of these feminists are absolutely very, very clear about what is at stake. And on the other hand, I think that the notion of collusion is somehow too strong because it doesn't pay attention to the fact that some of these alliances or convergences, as I say, are not intentional at all, but are more conjunctural. So the notion of convergence, in my view, is useful to understand what are these ideological matrices that bring them together, even though these movements hate each other and have nothing to do with each other. And secondly, what interest might right-wing nationalists, neoliberals and feminists or femocrats have in endorsing a type of politics that is, or at least appears to be, at odds with at least certain aspects of their political agenda? So what are they gaining out of this process in political terms? In order to answer the first question, I argue that the common ideological matrix bringing together these very different political actors is what a French anthropologist, Bessis, and also others now call it, Western supremacism, which is in some ways a new form. We can define it as a new form of nationalism. So to give you an example, in countries like France, Italy, and the Netherlands, we have seen, for example, a shift throughout the years from ethnic nationalism to cultural nationalism and Western supremacy. So I'm thinking here especially of Italy and France, whereas these parties like the Northern League or the Front National, the National Front, were very openly ethnically racist and nationalist just until the mid of the 2000s, especially after 9/11 and also after the mid of the 2000s in particular, they moved more and more to these forms of Western supremacism, which is to say that they speak more and more about the superiority of the West, the fact that it's the Western values that need to be saved and they need to be preserved from these contaminations. On the other hand, in the Netherlands, we see the opposite movement. Geert Wilders began as a strong Western supremacist. He began by saying Muslims are a problem against Western civilization, and throughout the years he became more and more an ethnic nationalist, talking about Dutchwood, the necessity to preserve the real roots and the purity of Dutchness, and so forth. So in all cases, however, what I want to stress is that nationalism comes in the guise of Western supremacy, which defines the perspective according to which Western principles and the Western civilization, which are usually described as the cradles of democracy, human rights, gender equality, and universalism, constitute a type of universal truth that marks the superiority of the West over the rest of the world. Most openly, of course, this perspective was put forward by Samuel Huntington in his very famous 1996 book, The Clash of Civilization and the Remaking of the World Order. Now, in stressing nationalism and Western supremacy as these overarching political matrices that inform this right-wing party stigmatization of Muslim and non-Western males, I suggest we should be critical of the tendency within the scholarly literature to define far-right parties like the PVV, the Party for Freedom, the National Front, and the Northern League as populists. Now these parties are usually in newspapers, but also in the literature called populists, and I think maybe this is it would be more clear in the discussion. I think there are quite some problems with this type of terminology. But the term populism, is employed to capture the demagogic nature of the embrace by these parties of themes that did not previously figure in their agendas, I argue that the concept of populism, at least on its own, fails to address the core ideological matrix that leads these right-wing parties to foreground the gender equality within xenophobic campaigns. As a modality of political mobilization that centered upon the binary us versus them, populism certainly can account for right-wing forces targeting Muslim and non-Western others as enemies of Western societies. However, it cannot explain the paradox according to which these parties do not frame Muslim and non-Western migrant women as enemies in the same way, and even offer to rescue them or to emancipate them. I thus contend that if we want to decipher this seeming paradox, we need to draw on theories of nationalism, particularly in the ways they are articulated within post-colonial feminism and the critical race studies. As these frameworks, especially post-colonial feminism, as shows, women are metaphorically central to the nationalist project because they are identified as the bearers of the collective and the biological reproducers of the nation. So understanding the nationalist trope, when we try to understand why these parties are using gender equality so much, I think it can help us to account for the narratives that identify Muslim and non-Western migrant women as victims to be rescued, because the type of nationalism these parties exhibit operates through a specific gendered and sexual binary. Notions such as sexualization of racism and the racialization of sexism, which can be difficult, we can unpack them later perhaps, and that were developed by postcolonial feminists and the critical race scholars, can help us to explicate how and why far-right nationalists apply different stereotypes to male and female foreigners, and why they portray sexism as the exclusive domain of the racialized other. It is also important to interrogate the arguments put forward by several prominent and influential feminist intellectuals and politicians, including of Muslim background, women's organizations, as well as femocrats from left to right in their anti-Islam campaigns. Despite the many political, theoretical, and biographical differences among these feminist actors, the common denominator of their anti-Islam stance is a fundamental agreement that gender relations in the West are more advanced and must be taught to Muslim women who are otherwise taken to be agentless objects at the mercy of their patriarchal cultures. It is this fundamental agreement on the superiority of the West that brings feminists and femocrats of different political stripes to position gender equality and Islamic practices and opposed. So what I'm trying to say is that especially this notion of Western supremacy, the notion that fundamentally the West is superior to the rest, is what is very contradictorily bringing together these far right-wing parties and these feminists. Even though they articulate these Western supremacism in very different ways, of course, nonetheless, is this fundamental belief that the West has something to teach to the rest in terms of gender equality, that is this common ideological matrix that I think is important to understand the convergence. The notion of convergence, I think, also helps us to answer the second question that I raised before, which is, what interests do these far-right parties and these feminists have to endorse a type of politics that is not really, it is at odds with parts of the political agendas? So why are feminists willing to be called racist, and why are far-right parties making so much fuss and talking about gender equality, why they couldn't care less about gender equality? Now, in asking this question, so in asking what are the interests here to be gained, I am drawing upon one very important American critical race scholar, who is Derrick Bell, who talks of the interest convergence theory. So his theory posits that the dominant racial group, and he's obviously talking specifically of racial relations in the United States, will support the subaltern racial group's fight for equal rights only if the former believes it has something to gain in the process. So he analyzes various cases in which Americans supported some of the battles for equal rights for African Americans by showing that at the end of the day, they did it only because they had something to gain politically out of this, and not because of any type of conversion or anti-racist real conviction. So transposing Bell's argument to the understanding of the convergence amongst the nationalists, neoliberals, and feminists on issues of gender equality and Islam in the three countries upon which I focus, I think we can try to explore the strategic calculations, the gains and losses, the benefits and costs for nationalists and feminists, in particular when endorsing a politics they had not previously endorsed. On the one hand, I think we can quite safely say that by encouraging a rhetoric of division or a Manichaean splitting of the political and ideological debate into one counterposing us, white, European, Western, Christian, civilized, women-friendly to them, the non-white, the non-European, non-Western, Muslim, uncivilized, misogynist others, right-wing nationalist parties have everything to gain. So in a historical conjunction in which the theme of gender equality, like that of human rights, has become the common currency in the name of which new racist and imperialist configurations of power become hegemonic, a vague mainstream idea of gender equality can quite easily be used opportunistically by these parties to contribute to the consolidation of the nationalist project. So in other words, far-right parties have everything to gain out of using in a very opportunistic way gender equality to enhance nationalism and their politics. On the other hand, I argue that by converging with anti-Islam and racist voices in the name of women's rights, feminists and femocrats effectively lose. That is, by suggesting that gender inequality is an issue affecting mostly non-European women, the anti-Islam feminists and femocrats have contributed to diverting attention away from the many forms of inequality that still affect Western European women. Neoliberal governments have seized on the opportunity opened up by the identification of women's rights as a migrant Muslim woman-only issue to decrease funds for more universal programs aimed at tackling gender injustice more generally. Instead of helping to gain more visibility, the widespread resort to the theme of women's rights as a civilizational battle demotes it from the rubric of gender societal problems and dislocates it as a non-Western women problem only, or as a problem that affects European women as potential victims of Muslim and non-Western or non-white men. So in other words, I can give you a very concrete example, which is, again, from the Netherlands. In the Netherlands now, the majority of funds for gender equality are given to programs for equality within migrant communities and for in order to support the emancipation of Muslim women and migrant women and women from ethnic minorities. But because all the attention of gender equality funds is on migrant women or women from ethnic minorities, they have in fact decreased the funds. They have taken money away from instead funds to tackle gender inequality more generally. So this is one of the effects, in a way, of this focus that also some feminists contributed to, obviously not all feminists, only some feminists, that have contributed to obsessing with the idea of gender inequality as a problem that is specifically inherent to Muslim cultures, and that's particularly acute in these communities. Now I'll move very, very briefly to explain why I talk of femonationalism as ideological formation before I enter into the actual core. I promise this is very brief, which is the political economy of femonationalism. So as I mentioned before, there are different names have been given to the political constellation emerging out of the intersection among nationalist, neoliberal, and feminist or LGBT politics in a range of countries. Some people say this is a zeitgeist or a discursive tactic or a political project, but for the most, scholars have pointed to the political dimensions of this phenomenon. More specifically, they have foregrounded the contemporary temporal junction in which these encounters take place, but I think they haven't paid sufficient attention to their materialities. For this reason, I argue that the convergence amongst nationalist right-wing parties and feminist and neoliberal policies is better captured in terms of an ideological formation. And here I will just mention one important reason why I think ideological formation is important. I conceptualize femonationalism as an ideological formation because I claim that the mobilization of gender equality by nationalist parties, neoliberals and feminists, in ways that intensify xenophobia, also stem from very concrete economic interests. In his seminal work, here I'm drawing on Althusser, which is ideology and ideological state apparatuses, Althusser invited us to think of the materiality of ideologies in terms of the ways in which they serve the reproduction of the material conditions of production, as he put it. That is, for Althusser, ideological state apparatuses, the family, the media, the school, religion, and so forth, play the role of guarantors in the reproduction of the conditions that recreate exploited labor power on a daily basis, both materially and psychologically. Althusser saw these apparatuses as functioning in a way that ensured the maintenance of the conditions for the subjection of the subaltern classes to, and their internalization of, the dominant ideology. In its Althusserian articulation, the notion of ideological formation, although Althusser does not speak exactly of ideological formation, maybe I can explain why I use this term, I think this notion urges us to explore femonationalism concrete materiality. So where does ideology come from in political economic terms? The notion of ideological formation, that is, suggests that we must examine the forms in which the convergence between this number of very heterogeneous political subjects on the notion that sexism is the exclusive domain of the non-Western other conceal the need to maintain and reproduce specific political economic arrangements. Ultimately, as I will explain now in the next part, the notion of femonationalism as ideological formation allows us to demonstrate how the xenophobic mobilization of gender equality reinforces the material chain of production and particularly social reproduction. So now I move to explain what is this political economy of femonationalism? What are these economic interests, we can say, or these economic dimensions behind this ideology. So as I said at the beginning, there are very few studies, I think I mentioned this, that have tried to explore the political economic foundations of these ideological convergences. So more generally, as I repeatedly said, the majority of works that try to make sense of these paradoxes have tried to look at the political dimensions, the zeitgeist, the post 9/11 conjuncture, the fact that now everyone can talk about gender equality and so forth. There are a few studies, however, that have attempted to take into account the political economic dimensions of the turn to gender and gay equality by conservative neoliberal racist politics. And most of them really refer to neoliberalism as a type of background force. For example, there is a Canadian author, Sirma Bilge, who maintains that the possibility for gender and sexuality to become the operation field of racist and imperialist nationalism is mainly due to their fittingness with the neoliberal mode of hiding structural inequalities behind cultural conflicts. End of the quote. This was a quote from Bilge. So basically what she's saying is that all these far-right parties are referring to the problems with Muslims in terms of gender inequality, because it is much easier to displace the debate on cultural terms rather than talk about the structural inequalities in states where these communities are. And there are two other authors that more or less try to say the same thing. So basically, they try to maintain that these convergences are consistent with neoliberal strategies of market segmentation and the promotion of chauvinist politics. And this idea that neoliberalism enables this displacement of structural inequalities under the guise of cultural problems. So these studies, this is my critique of these studies. I think they tend to treat neoliberalism as the economic theater of operation for the encounter between these very different array of forces, but not as one of the main characters on stage. So I think that they somehow treat the relationship between the economic dimension and this femonationalist ideology as an indirect relationship, as something that just stems from the fact that it's occurring in a neoliberal conjuncture. But I don't think they explore deeply what are really the connections, the direct connections. While I agree that neoliberalism is central for understanding these phenomena, I argue that neoliberalism is not simply the contextual ground on which the femonationalist convergence takes place, but it is itself constitutive of such a convergence. The mobilization of women's rights within xenophobic campaigns, which has become very prominent under neoliberalism, does not merely divert attention away from growing economic inequalities by means of culturalist modes of displacement, nor has such mobilization operated solely through making equal rights campaigns functional to consumerist culture. Rather, I understand the neoliberalism to be a political economic formation that has institutionalized the femonationalist ideology as part of the functioning of the state apparatuses in order to reorganize the productive and particularly social reproductive sphere. And obviously now I'm going to give you very concrete examples of this. The chief example here is the so-called civic integration programs for third country nationals. These are programs, they are called civic integration, because since the mid of the 2000s, they have been established in several European countries in order to basically ask that migrants familiarize themselves with the language, the cultures, and values of the country in which they want to live in order to be granted a resident permit. I think there is a version of civic integration in Germany. I'm not too familiar with its exact dynamics, but what is particularly interesting about the countries I focus on, France, the Netherlands, and Italy, is that within these civic integration programs, gender equality is very prominent. So basically, within these programs, they ask migrants to respect the gender equality. Gender equality in these programs is presented as one of the most important values of these European countries that these migrants need to respect. Obviously, the subtext behind this is that they need to be familiarized to gender equality because they don't really know what it is. They need to be taught gender equality because they live in societies which are unequal from a gender point of view. So gender equality within these programs is incredibly, it becomes a leitmotif, it's constantly there. These migrants are continuously exposed to ideas that women are equal to men. You might have heard a few years ago it was quite popular, the example of the Netherlands, because the Dutch government in 2005 produced a video which was meant to be shown to migrants planning to go to the Netherlands. And in this video, there are images of topless women that are sunbathing on these beaches in the Netherlands. And this created lots of there were lots of discussions about this. Basically, the idea was that, of course, these migrants need to be shown that gender equality means women can show their bodies and even be topless on beaches, which was obviously one of the strongest examples of how gender equality is used within these materials. But they are there in a very pervasive way. This brings me to say that civic integration programs have been studied very much from a cultural point of view. So most studies look at these programs and the ways in which they emphasize the cultural aspects, how migrants need to learn Dutch or German or Italian, how they need to learn the values of these countries, familiarize themselves with these new cultural constellations and so forth. However, these programs have very strong economic dimensions that I think are quite understudied. It's just in the last few years there are more works that are actually paying attention to this economic dimension. So we should note, for example, that civic integration programs, since 2007, the European Union established the European Integration Fund for third country nationals. And this fund was meant to fund, to give money to initiatives and programs across the European Union for initiatives to help migrants to integrate, okay? And especially to integrate economically. But the aspect of economic integration within these documents was very much emphasized in the case of migrant women. So, there was a proliferation of statistical data, studies and policy documents in those years that showed that migrant women actually had lower levels of employment and activity rates when compared with those on with those of migrant men. So the idea was we need to push migrant women to take jobs and to become economically integrated because they are less economically integrated than men. More or less explicitly, the lower rates of participation of these women in the workforce were attributed to their backward cultural backgrounds, which were deemed responsible for keeping these migrant, especially Muslim women, in a state of subjection and economic independence. So the idea fundamentally was the idea behind that these women don't really are not really very active in the labor market because they come for backward cultures that oblige them to stay at home and that don't encourage them to participate in the public sphere. So since 2007, there have been lots of projects all across Europe that have been funded specifically to enable the economic integration of migrant women. They have been of different types. In some cases, they fund projects to teach migrant women the language of the country, which is supposed to be, it is a way of helping them to find a job. But in many cases, these programs actually are very, they actually help them actively to seek a job. The case of the Netherlands here is particularly emblematic. So in 2003, the then Minister for Integration and Immigration, the very far-right nationalist Rita Verdonk, created the PAVEM, which is it is a commission for the participation of ethnic minority women. So it is one of the ways in which now the Dutch government is funding especially organizations that work on gender equality for migrant women. So in 2007, the then Minister for Education, Culture and Science, which is also in responsible for gender equality, launched the so-called 1001 Force, the 1001 Force project, which had been previously designed by this PAVEM commission, this commission for the equality of ethnic minority women. This project sought to encourage women undergoing civic integration programs to participate in civil society by explicitly inviting them to undertake volunteer work. In a bizarre twist of means and ends, unpaid volunteer work was presented as the most important way, or via maestra, for reaching the goal of economic independence. This 1001 Force project stressed the opportunities provided by working as a volunteer for those migrant women who wished to discover their strengths, assess their capabilities, and be ready for future paying employment. However, as two Dutch scholars, Kirk and Suvarierol, note, this project was implemented despite the availability of research results that were conducted by the Dutch Institute for Social Research that showed that most migrant women interviewed would not welcome unpaid volunteer work. In particular, they would not wish to carry out the specific type of volunteer work that the project mostly encouraged them to take. That is care work in hospitals, children facilities, care and domestic work in private households, in homes for elderly people, and in homes of disabled people. So in other words, all the works that were proposed to migrant women, even for free, so they were asked to work for free, were all in the social reproductive sector, or in the care and domestic sector. Also, the request for migrant women to undertake volunteer work in the care and domestic sector is not found either in France or the Netherlands. At least in France and the Netherlands, they don't ask migrant women to volunteer, at least. The situation in these two countries is not very different when it comes to implementing economic integration for women migrating from outside the European Union, the Global South. So if we look at civic integration programs and initiatives also in these other countries, as I try to do by looking at all the initiatives that were funded to help migrant women to integrate, we can see very clearly that the majority of these programs have actually very openly channeled these migrant women towards the care and domestic sector. So in other words, they are systematically directed to work as nannies, babysitters, housekeepers, domestic workers, and so forth. So in spite of the great emphasis, what I should say actually, which is quite important, is that many of these initiatives have been carried out by some feminist organizations or some women's organizations, and very often under the auspices of women working in state bureaucracies. So, for example, the Department for Equal Opportunities in Italy has been very active in promoting these initiatives. So there is a certain role also of some women's organizations in promoting this type of economic integration for women, which is, as I tried to explain, very, very specific. So the jobs that they take are only these jobs in the social reproductive sector. So what I want to emphasize is that in spite of the great emphasis which is placed on the need for these women to emancipate themselves by entering the productive public sphere, which is done by various, for instance, women's organizations or right-wing parties using gender equality, in reality, these migrant women have been confined to this care and domestic sector. So what I want to claim is that there is a contradiction, at least a contradiction, when feminists and femocrats, which I want to emphasize is not all feminists and femocrats, it's only some of them, we can discuss this later perhaps, there is a contradiction when they urge emancipation for Muslim and non-Western migrant women while channeling them towards the very sphere from which the feminist movement had historically tried to liberate women. And this is not just a rhetorical contradiction, and it is concretely performed in action. But it is here important to mention also the active role of right-wing governments and some nationalist right-wing parties in directing these women into the care and domestic or social reproductive sector. For example, during the global economic crisis of 2007 and 2011, the Berlusconi government in Italy shut down new quotas for immigration. So immigrants were no longer accepted in Italy. And this was presented as a response to the economic crisis. So according to the Berlusconi government, there was no need anymore of migrants because the crisis meant that lots of Italian workers now could supply the demand for jobs. However, an exception was made for domestic and care workers, for whom a record quota of more than 100,000 positions was established. So in 2009, the government granted an amnesty only for illegal migrants working as carers and domestic workers, since that was considered the only sector where the demand for labor could not meet the national supply. On this occasion, for example, Roberto Maroni, which was is one of the most important leaders of the Northern League, although obviously he is very anti-immigration, and you can see behind me there is a poster here that says enough is enough, just get out of this country, and you see images of men, Muslim men, presumably praying. Obviously, it's a very strong anti-Islam and anti-immigration parties that campaigns constantly against immigrants. But nonetheless, Maroni, on the occasion of the amnesty for care and domestic workers, he said there cannot be a regularization for those who entered illegally, for those who rape a woman or rob a villa, but certainly we will take into account all those situations that have a strong social impact, as in the case of migrant caregivers. Right-wing anti-immigration parties, such as the Northern League, thus were willing to close an eye to undocumented migrants when they were women working in the care and domestic sector, precisely because these women were incredibly needed in the economy, despite the economic crisis. From a neoliberal economic point of view, in fact, what the Berlusconi government did was quite wise. 3 years ago, I carried out a detailed analysis of data on non-Western migrants' economic performance in terms of employment trends and sectors between 2007 and 2013. So just to cut it very short, here I'm showing you a table from the OECD, I believe this is from 2012, yes, so it was done just immediately after the global economic crisis. But you don't need to read the table in detail, but it just shows what are the sectors in Europe with the largest changes in foreign-born employment in the European Union. So you can see that all the manufacturing in particular and the construction activity, we have huge losses of jobs, so it's all negative. Whereas in the case of residential care activities, activities of households, as employers of domestic personnel, education and human health activities, what we call social reproduction, or the care and domestic sector, they're all positive. There was actually an increase in jobs. So more migrant women were employed during the economic crisis and even after the economic crisis than before. So in other words, the global economic crisis did not affect migrant women who are mostly employed in the care and domestic sector, whereas it affected quite heavily migrant men who are employed in other sectors like constructions, as I said, and manufacture. And one of the reasons is that this is the sector to which capital's classic crisis management operations do not apply. Because the social reproduction, if you think of housekeeping or child minding or care for the elderly or sectors like education, they cannot simply be shut down because of an economic crisis in the same way as it can be done for construction and manufacture. But there is constantly the need of someone who does that. And in a context of aging population in which the demand for these jobs is on the rise, because of the fast aging of the European population, but also in a context of withdrawal of many women from these jobs. So many European women are not longer willing to do these tasks for free, like they were under Fordism, under breadwinner model, but now they want to work outside the household. So it is increasingly migrant women who are providing the supply for these huge and growing demand. So the emphasis on non-Western migrant women overall, Muslim and non-Muslim alike, as individuals to be helped in their integration and emancipation process, including through job offers, or including through offers of economic integration, is possible, I think, because these women, unlike male migrant workers, currently occupy a strategic role in the social reproductive sector of childcare, elderly care, and cleaning. So rather than job stealers or cultural and social threats, which usually are definitions that are used very much against migrants, but if you think about it, it's mainly against migrant males. They are the most accused of stealing jobs from national populations and from national workers. So instead of these definitions, Muslim and non-Western migrant women seem to be those who actually are allowing Western European women and men in particular to work in the public sphere by providing the care that neoliberal restructuring has commodified. So in conclusion, what I want to suggest is that this double standard that is applied to Muslim and non-Western migrant women in the public imaginary as individuals that are in need of special attention and even rescue or even emancipation. So this double standard operates as an ideological tool that is strictly connected to their key role, present or future or potential, in the reproduction of the material conditions of social reproduction. Femonationalism, I think, should be understood as part and parcel of the specifically neoliberal reorganization of welfare, labor, and state immigration policies that have occurred in the context of the global financial crisis, and more generally, the Western European crisis of social reproduction. The very possibility that nationalists and neoliberals can exploit emancipatory ideals of gender equality, as well as the convergence of some feminists and femocrats within anti-emancipatory and xenophobic politics, springs in large part from the specifically neoliberal configuration of the Western European economy in the past 35 years. Thank you very much.
Ja, die These ist, glaube ich, sehr klar geworden. Zum Schluss nochmal. Und du hast viele Fäden zusammengebracht, um das deutlich zu machen. Trotzdem gibt es bestimmt und hoffentlich viele Fragen oder auch Kommentare. Und auch Verständnisfragen natürlich sind möglich. Und ich habe vergessen, darum würde ich euch parallel noch bitten, es geht erstens eine Adressliste rum, wo ihr euch bitte, bitte eintragt. Das brauchen wir für unsere Geldgeber. Und wir würden diese Veranstaltung auch gerne evaluieren. Und dazu gehen gleich nochmal Bögen rum. Und wenn ihr Zeit habt, wären wir sehr dankbar, wenn ihr das noch ausfüllt, bevor ihr geht später. Das muss nicht jetzt gleich sofort sein. Vielen Dank. Gibt's Bemerkungen?
Yeah, thank you very much for your very concise and clear argument. You started by saying that there is not only a convergence of the feminist plus right wing, but also the LGBTIQ movements in some countries. But when you turned to the economic rationale, you were focusing on the feminist idea. So, do you have any examples in how far an LGBTIQ, you know, rights defenders, how would they converge into some, you know, economic project?
In der letzten Reihe.
Hi, my question would be, thank you for your talk. I didn't quite get how the different actors that you named work together in this neoliberal frame that you talk about. So once I felt that you addressed right-wing activists, then there were like some feminist activists, and then there were like governmental politics, sometimes European politics. And I feel that this was like, for me, I didn't quite understand if they like all, like the feminists, the right wing, the governments, and the European Union all together try to impose this politics that you, if they're like having a, I didn't quite understand how they work together. My other question would be, have you also taken into account, you said that the Front National would no longer be homophobic, I would strongly object to this, the fact that Marine Le Pen has, it's true, not spoken out publicly about the gay marriage does not mean that not many members of the Front National have participated in activities against, and that there's the homophobia in Front National takes on different forms, that's true, like also regarding to class, also in regarding to religious involvements of the participants of Front National, but it's I completely disagree that Front National would no longer be homophobic. And this leads to my last question, that in many contexts in Europe, these right-wing actors actually at the same time use gender or sexual modernism or modernity to express their racism against Muslim communities. And yet, at the same time, these actors also strongly ally with what some people call like anti-genderism, or like I would say that they would not subscribe to like what you identified as like European gender politics or something. They are absolutely opposed to that. So, did you take these elements into account?
Ich frage auf Deutsch und dann, ja, naja, sonst kann ich es noch übersetzen. Mich würde interessieren, erstens die Frage, welche Rolle spielen emanzipatorische, feministische Gruppierungen in LGBT-Gruppierungen? Also wie ist das Kräfteverhältnis? Ja, the relation of forces between or of the one side and maybe on the other side, feminist groups, LGBT groups. I mean, because you presented now just the one side to have a full picture of the problem, yeah? And the second problem I have is, what do you propose or what do you think by those programs, state programs, yeah, to organize some integration into the labor market? I mean, not run by those groups, but there are others, you know, because the left here is fighting for social infrastructure, for integration programs, yeah, just to help people to get into the labor market, to, yeah, to find a job, to be trained on the jobs and so on. So, but you know, it's not all the same. And so what are with the things in between, you know?
Okay. Yeah, I kind of want to follow up on the question that came from the woman in the back, because you said that right-wing parties and organizations mostly have to can gain from these femo-nationalist politics, and feminists can only lose. And you named the example of the cuts for funds, but I'm not so quite sure if this is always the case, because as she said, there's this thing called Genderwahn in German, and the right-wing parties position themselves very clearly. They don't want to be aligned with anything that has to do with progressive gender politics, so they might lose a lot of their potential electors. And there's also people who call themselves feminists, like Alice Schwarzer, who has to gain from her racist politics in a kind of media currency, because she goes everywhere, she gets lots of applause from different positions. So yeah, I would like to know what you think about that.
Okay, thanks for all these questions, because I think and I hope they will help me to clarify what I meant. I mean, you just have to imagine a little bit that it's quite difficult to try to summarize all of these arguments in a talk. And obviously, I guess I should really clarify some of these points to be entirely clear. So first of all, I want to respond first to the issue of the Front National being now not being homophobic. That's absolutely not what I meant. Of course, the Front National, the National Front in France, is still extremely homophobic, and the majority of its members probably are. It is also true that it distances itself from gender theory, and there were huge campaigns against this. At the same time, the Front National, what I said is that occasionally and very instrumentally, there were instances in which Marine Le Pen used and instrumentalized issues of LGBT rights against Muslims, which is not the same thing as saying they are not homophobic. So I was simply trying to say that she toned down the issues of homophobia, unlike her father, who was much more openly homophobic. Marine Le Pen didn't discuss much the issue of homophobia or gay rights. Precisely, she wanted to keep it silent. First, because she used it instrumental against Muslims by saying Muslim communities are homophobic, but also because the National Front is trying also to catch another electorate, which is made of also of some homosexuals and especially quite prominent gay men in France who now have openly come in support of Marine Le Pen and the National Front. So now there are lots of gay men that actually openly support the National Front. And because she is conducting what she calls the de-demonization campaign, she's trying to present the Front National as a more liberal, open party to certain rights, and so in this sense, obviously, it is quite opportunistically useful for her not to touch too much on the issue of gay rights, and even to exploit it and instrumentalize it. Just to clarify, I absolutely didn't mean to say the party is not homophobic. There are many contradictions. I mean, these parties. The same goes for the Dutch Party for Freedom. These parties are extremely incoherent. We were discussing about this during the lunch break. These parties are extremely incoherent. They can, on the one hand, promote the rights of gays and homosexuals if it's convenient in a certain anti-Islam campaign, while at the same time supporting anti-gender theory campaigns. And it's all instrumental to speak to different sections of the electorate and the population. So I think we need to understand these contradictions and also these different levels. Of course, they remain absolutely anti-feminist, But I'm not saying that when they exploit gender equality is because they have become feminists. That's absolutely not my intention. My point was to show how they are exploiting and instrumentalizing gender equality because it is convenient in anti-Islam campaigns to present Muslims as a threat, and especially as a sexual threat to these European nations. Of course, it is an instrumentalization, because when we look at the concrete policies of these parties, either they don't have an agenda on gender equality, like in the case of the Dutch Party for Freedom, it doesn't have anything about gender equality in its political program, or, as in the case of the National Front in France, the type of gender equality that they promote, or the type, perhaps more precisely, the type of gender policies that they promote is entirely traditional. So they want women to be mothers. They promote what is called like the salary for parenthood, which would allow particularly women to stay at home if they have at least two children, or I think it is at least three children. So of course, their programs on gender equality are extremely, extremely traditionalist and extremely anti-feminist in many ways. But at the same time, they use rhetorically the lexicon of women's rights and gender equality when it comes to attack Muslims. So these are the complexities that we need to understand and that I was trying to explain. The question on the political economy, I focus on the issue of women's rights. I didn't do any specific work on the issue of LGBT rights, so I wouldn't have my own answer to this. But honestly, I know a little bit the literature, and the majority of works that try to understand the instrumentalization of gay rights from a more economic perspective do what I explained a little bit, which is they try to say We are in a neoliberal conjuncture in which now there is a market for gay consumerism, and neoliberalism can also work through the promotion of certain markets, while at the same time the instrumentalization of gay rights. But I wouldn't say goes beyond this. I think this is where the political economy of this really points to. Okay, someone also asked me to explain a little bit better who is converging. And again, thanks for this question, because it is, I realize today, also giving this lecture, how difficult it is to really convey all these complexities and all these layers that I work with in this book. So the actors I'm focusing on and that are converging are right-wing parties. I look at how right-wing parties, these three right-wing parties specifically, instrumentalize gender equality on the one hand. On the other hand, I look at how certain feminists and certain women's organizations have also used the issue of gender equality. Especially the front of the feminists is particularly difficult to understand because it is very transversal. So whereas in the case of the right-wing parties, we know what we are looking at. So it is nationalist right-wing parties that are instrumentally using gender equality against Muslims and against immigrants, because it's not just Muslims, it is also immigrants, non-Western immigrants more generally that are under the spotlight, that are considered rapists and a sexual threat and so forth. In the case, when we look at the women using, the feminists using anti-Islam slogans or attacking Islam in the name of gender equality, the camp is much more complex and is much more layered. It goes from left to right. In a country like Italy, for example, both left-wing feminists, not all of them, again, I really want to emphasize this. It doesn't include all the feminist universe, but many left-wing feminists and also right-wing feminists are increasingly have called for the ban of the burqa, for example, from public spaces. They have converged in attacking the Muslim veil, in attacking Islam, in the name of secularism. So the feminist front is particularly complex because we have these political differences between these feminists. So what I try to say is that, of course, these feminists endorsing anti-Islam arguments are very different between amongst each other. And they are very different on many levels, biographically, politically. Obviously, right-wing feminists do not have the same policies and politics of left-wing feminists. But at the same time, they agree on the fact that Islam is a problem. They agree on the fact that the veil is a symbol of oppression. So what I try to say is that how do we explain this agreement in feminists that diverge on everything else and they disagree on everything else? And I think one explanation, at least, I try to propose is that what they have together is that they fundamentally believe that the West is superior, is more civilizationally advanced when it comes to gender relations. So fundamentally, they would say that in Western countries, gender relations are more advanced. There is more gender equality as compared to other countries. They say this with different tones and with different accents and nuances, but this is the fundamental agreement. And that's why I talked of, we can say, Westocentrism, or, as some authors do, Western supremacism. I hope this makes it a little bit clearer. Alex was asking about the role of feminists, and I hope this clarifies a little bit. Perhaps I should add also that there are also lots of feminists in these countries that are absolutely against this instrumentalization and that disagree with the idea that the veil should be banned. and they don't think that this is a priority, and they regard this endorsement of women's rights as a form of racism, women's rights against Islam as a form of racism. So there is also quite a large component of feminists that is against all of this. However, these anti-Islam feminists are much more vocal, and certainly they have been put on the spotlight by the mainstream media. So it is, they are quite more well-known, also because some very well-known feminists endorse these positions, and therefore their position came to the front in these countries as the feminist position against Islam, even though they don't represent all feminists. So I think it's quite important also to say that. On the issue of integration, I see what you mean. Of course, it is a controversial issue, because on the one hand, of course, it is very useful. I mean, it's very important to have programs that promote the integration of migrants in different ways. Obviously, we might want to have a discussion on what is integration, but nonetheless, certainly, I would say it is very useful and important to have language courses for free. Like in this sense, France is quite advanced because it provides migrants with lessons, with classes on the French language for free. Migrants don't have to pay for that, and I think this is quite, certainly quite useful. I think it's a positive thing. On the other hand, what I question is the ways in which economic integration for women, on the one hand, is presented as an advancement, as if migrant women would be emancipated by entering the labor market and the public sphere. But on the other hand, the jobs they get are not jobs in the public sphere. They are jobs in the private sphere. They are still the jobs that women do not want to do. European women do not want to do the babysitters, or at least many European women do not want to do all those jobs against which they rebelled during the feminist movements of the 60s and the 70s. In many ways, the feminist movements, particularly the second wave feminists, was a struggle and a battle against the confinement of women in the public sphere. So what I question is, how does it come that emancipation for these women is so much portrayed as something positive, as something that needs to be promoted, but then they end up in those roles that are, first of all, gender roles. They just reproduce certain gender categories and gender tasks. And also they are very increasingly racialized, because these are the niches of the labor market in which more and more we find migrants, because they are low paid, they are jobs in which usually migrants work for many, many hours, they have a very unsafe and unregulated contracts, and so forth. So there is at least a problem in the ways in which this economic integration is promoted. The last question was, some feminists are gaining individually. I think this is true. And I think you gave a very good example. Alice Schwarzer, certainly, she is gaining in terms of popularity and exposure to the public media by attacking Islam, of course. My point wanted to be, perhaps I should be clearer on this, that I think the program of gender equality is losing, because even though Alice Schwarzer or Elisabeth Badinter in France or other well-known feminists have all the attention of the mass media on them because they attack Islam, nonetheless, they are contributing to reinforce and consolidate the idea that now the problem is the Muslims, that now the problem is that these women do not know what is gender equality, whereas the European women are emancipated. And this is not just a rhetorical problem. It is also a very concrete one, because as I try to say, this type of rhetoric is playing within state funds. Now states and governments are taking money away from gender equality departments and programs, and they are putting this money into programs for the equality of ethnic minority and migrant women, because those are the women who allegedly need equality. So I hope this is clear. It is a collective and more general issue. It is how gender equality as an issue advances in this conjuncture.
Yeah. Okay. I would like to thank you for the interesting talk you gave us. My question is, you look at this discussion from a political economy point of view, and my interest is more into the other side, basically. You're looking at how what is pronounced in the public sphere by politicians and by feminists and femocrats and so on. And what I'm more interested in is why are they saying that? And I think you're losing something by only looking at it from a political economy perspective, because the interesting thing in this whole discussion is, from my point of view, how much emotional energy enters into it, you know. And if you discuss about the wheel or something, there's so much emotional energy that comes into it that it cannot just be explained by normal politics. It's more that there must be strong psychological forces. Mm-hmm. And this usually is a projection. And if you look at it from this point of view, then that right-wing politicians are at the same time wanting to liberate Muslim women, and at the same time are kind of like blocking everything on progressive gender politics, is not so much a contradiction anymore, because isn't basically a projection that what they signal to their followers is they would like to have so much control over their women as they imagine in their fantasy that Muslim men have over their women, because
the Muslim men, sorry,
that Muslim men have over their women. You know, I mean, it's a projection on the fantasy, you know, of how much control. You know, if you see this emotional energy that's in this wheel debate, you know, whale debate. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. yeah. The wheel is something you eat. Yeah. is it not in the end? A projection on. They would like to have the same control, no, over their own woman. As they imagine these men to have the control over their womb. Is it not in the end an envious position that's brought into it? I mean, just from this point of view, it wouldn't be so much a contradiction, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hello. Okay, thank you for the presentation and for two very revealing observations, of which I'm not sure how they connect. So there's a transformation in the caregiving sector, and there is the convergence in Western supremacy thought. And I just wonder, as a question, whether you found agents, women, people in these movements, in these political movements that were aware of the political economic transformation, the caregiving sector, and that had an interest in this transformation, and therefore becoming sort of also the perpetrators of this ideological scheme that you presented. Otherwise, I'm not quite sure if these two observations you made actually sort of come together. Or maybe I missed some point, and then I would be thankful if you could clarify.
Sorry, just to if I understand your question, what is that you don't, what is the connection that you don't see? Because I'm not sure I understand what you're asking me.
Okay, I try once again. Mm-hmm. You have a political economic argument, mm-hmm, saying that the caregiving sector is transforming with migrant women taking over caregiving work that once before was made by female. And you have on the other side the observation, and it sounded to me that this Western supremacy thought, this moment of convergence among these very heterogeneous political groups on the far right operates on this idea that the women that are migrants should take over these jobs or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ich würde gerne noch mal etwas genauer verstehen, wie ich den Begriff des instrumentellen Benutzens von dem Vorwurf der Homophobie verstehen soll oder des strategischen Nutzens Gebrauches. Also, weil für mich hat das so ein bisschen die Tendenz zu unterstellen, dass die diese Homophobie, die sie kritisieren, nicht tatsächlich fürchten und dass sie nicht tatsächlich darin ein Problem sehen. Weil wenn ich sage, das wird nur instrumentell gemacht, dann unterstelle ich ja, dass es eben nicht so gemeint ist. Eigentlich ist das nicht der Punkt, sondern es geht um was anderes. Und das verstehe ich nicht ganz. Also um was geht es dann ganz anderes? Also was ist sozusagen dann das Ziel dieses strategischen Handelns oder instrumentellen Handelns? Und wieso unterstellen Sie, dass die das nicht wirklich ein Problem finden? Weil Alice Schwarzer findet das ein Problem. Die hat davor Angst, die findet das schrecklich, die hat das Gefühl, das, wofür sie gekämpft hat, wird in Frage gestellt durch Gruppen, die, ich teile das nicht, das ist nicht mein Punkt, nur ich glaube nicht, dass es Sinn macht, wenn es darum geht, diese Begriffe so zu benutzen, das so zu tun. Weil ich glaube, dass es keinen Sinn macht, den Menschen immer zu unterstellen, sie würden das nur instrumentell tun, weil sie, eigentlich haben sie ein falsches Bewusstsein über das, was sie tun, oder sie wissen genau, dass sie eigentlich was anderes wollen. Das sind ja dann die beiden. Ja. Und das würde ich gerne noch ein bisschen genauer verstehen.
Okay. Again, thanks for these questions that I hope they will make some of the arguments again a bit clearer. On the first question, you asked why I focus only on political economy and why I take out some other elements. That's not really what I try to do. What I try to say is that there is a debate, an international debate, which is engaging especially scholars of queer studies, sociologists, anthropologists. So there are lots of people, really. And I would say it's probably more in France and in Britain and in the United States that they have tried to understand what's going on with these right-wing parties somehow using this language of gay rights or women's rights, okay? So there is it's a large field of studies. So what I try to do is to make a contribution to this field of study by saying in this field of study there is a certain emphasis which is placed upon more cultural or political understandings of this phenomenon. So in other words, the majority of the scholars would say that the reason why now right-wing parties are instrumentalizing gender equality is because after 9/11, this is a very powerful argument, particularly after the bombing of Afghanistan was presented as the way of liberating Afghani women and so as the export of democracy into Afghanistan and so forth. So particularly after the very powerful image and metaphor of the war on terror as also a war of liberation of Afghani women and Muslim women. So in this political constellation and specific historical conjuncture, these parties are simply using the trope of women's rights in a political sense. So it's just, if you want, a conjunctural analysis, okay? And what I'm trying to say is that obviously these elements are very important. I'm not saying that they don't play a role, but I think there is also an economic, political economic dimension that I think we need to understand. And what I propose, and maybe this also answers your question, is that the political economic dimension, in my view, is basically that we need to understand why are Muslim women or also migrant non-Western women presented with offers of salvation? Why are the Afghani women, why do the Afghani women deserve salvation and liberation and the Afghani men don't? So why there is this dichotomy between these two migrants universe, so these two non-Western universes, which is the men on the one hand who are the bad guys, the evil, the sexual threat, the ones that cannot be assimilated, and the ones who need to be either deported or expelled for our societies, or at least they need to be neutralized politically. And on the other hand, the women have a completely different role in this imaginary. They are the victims. Usually they put a veil on because the man forces them to do them, so we need to take this veil off in order to liberate them. Maybe they can be assimilated or economically integrated if they agree to become like Western European women. So if they behave like Western European women, dress like Western European women, are mothers like Western European women, work like Western European women, and so forth. So if you just, I think you can even have this idea in front of you, if you just have what the newspapers, how the newspapers present these arguments. It's quite easy to see that there is a dichotomization between the men and the women. The women are the victims, the men are the oppressors. What I'm trying to say is that this dichotomization is not just due to these cultural, rhetorical appropriations and instrumentalizations, but there is also a political economic dimension. And that is the women need to be saved at the moment, or saved obviously in this rhetorical sense, because they are absolutely necessary to the European economy at the moment, because these women are the ones supplying the labor market with carers that are incredibly needed at the moment. If you look at the statistics on the workers who work in these sectors, the majority of these workers are migrant women. There are increasingly a huge number of Muslim women working in these sectors, and that's why I say that's why I emphasize that these civic and economic policies are trying to integrate these women by channeling them towards these sectors. Because again, these women are extremely needed in the European economy, in the labor market. So I'm saying that if they are presented in a different way, it's also because there is the need for these women. On the other hand, with the men, the issue is much more controversial, because particularly in the period of the economic crisis, it is true that many of the sectors that employ migrant men saw the loss of lots of jobs. So there was a decrease of demand for migrant men, particularly during the years of the crisis. So in a way, what I'm trying to say is that the men are more disposable from an economic point of view, at least in specific historical conjunctures like the one I'm describing, whereas the women, even in a period of crisis, they are incredibly needed. That's my political economic take on this issue. Now, this doesn't mean that there are not also psychological dimensions to these forms of dichotomization or culturalist dimension. I mean, they are huge. And this is exactly what post-colonial feminists try to explain. There is a huge literature, again, on how during colonialism, for example, in Algeria, in the case of French colonialism, or in Indonesia, in the case of Dutch colonialism, or in Eritrea, and in Ethiopia, in the case of Italian colonialism, there was, again, this dichotomization I'm talking about. The men were the sexual threat, they were the danger, they were the ones to be humiliated and kept under control, whereas the women were the victims to be saved, or at least the properties of the colonial masters, of the colonial colonizers. And there were many instances for example, just to give an example about colonialism, French colonialists, even in Algeria, tried to carry out what they were called emancipation campaigns. So in between 1951 and 1953, I think, if I remember the date correctly, they carried out these campaigns in which Muslim women in Algeria were asked to take the veil off, or there were ceremonies in which they actually took their veil off, and there were psychological warfare specialists working on this, because the idea was the Algerian men need to be humiliated. They need to understand that their women are our properties. So there is, I would say that, I don't see much what you described. I'm not sure it is an envy. I mean, I've never thought about this in these terms, to be honest. I need to think a bit more. But I think it is more than the envy for their control, which might be perhaps at a deep psychological level, but I think it is also the need to humiliate these men by taking control over the bodies of these Muslim women. And by saying, we can use the bodies of your women the way we want, and we can undress them. So I think that there is much more this going on. I find these dimensions, the psychological dimensions of racism and these cultural dimensions, extremely difficult to handle personally, because I do believe they play a huge role. I'm not denying that in any way whatsoever, but I always wonder about what are the trans-historical possibilities of understanding all these elements, even though we see patterns across the world and in different contexts. I know there are studies that try to understand racism in historical perspective from a psychological point of view, even materialist ones. I know of a Marxist scholar who wrote a book which I haven't read yet, I just ordered, which is called Racism, a Psychohistory, in which he tries to reconstruct racism as the psychological dimensions of racism over history, and especially of these binary, the differences in which racism is played out for women and for men. But I find it extremely difficult to handle. So I would say they are incredibly important as dimensions, but I don't know them, these theories, well enough to be able to say more about it, although I really want to explore them. If I understood your question correctly, the instrumentalization, I think what you're asking me is, for instance, in the case of Alice Schwarzer, she genuinely believes that Islam is misogynist. Was this your question? So in this case, she's not instrumentalizing, or she's not instrumentalized? Is this what you asked me, right? So I think you're right, but I think what I'm trying to say is that right-wing parties are instrumentalizing feminism, or better, are instrumentalizing women's rights, the issue of women's rights. Obviously, they instrumentalize and exploit these issues because they are not at the core of their policies or of their political programs. They're using them opportunistically only in order to attack Muslims at the moment. They will be very happy to get rid of this instrumentalization probably in a few years' time, or even just in the next years if they become more powerful. And I think in a way we are witnessing already a little bit of a change. So I think right-wing parties are becoming much more aggressive now towards Muslim women. I think the rhetoric of rescuing them, of liberating them, is still there, but it's not as strong as it was a few years ago. I think that now they are much more openly assimilationist. I think they now would say to Muslim women much more strongly, you take the veil off because I tell you to do so, because you live in this country, and here we don't want women veiled this way. I think that the idea you should take the veil off because then you're liberated is much less there. I mean, it's still there, but I think it's playing a less prominent role because we are in a very racist conjuncture, and racism is on the rise, so they are much more outspoken about this. In the case of feminists, I'm not saying that they are instrumentalized. That is exactly the reason why I don't talk about instrumentalization, because I think it would be also very paternalistic to feminists to say they have been instrumentalized by right-wing parties. I think they are endorsing an anti-Islam politics because they genuinely believe that Islam is a problem, is a religious, because of the patriarchy of Islam, because it is a religion and religions certainly oppress women and so forth. So I think the women in this sense are not instrumentalizing the issue of gender equality. They are very openly endorsing gender equality against what they see as an enemy of gender equality. My critique to them is that by doing so in this specific historical conjuncture, they are, even if unconsciously or unwittingly, even if they don't want to, they are speaking the same language of the right-wing parties. I don't think this is the historical conjuncture in which, I mean, any attack against Islam and Muslims in this conjuncture is a racist attack. That's my point. I hope.
Okay, I see people leaving.
Yeah,
it's late.
It's late.
I have the impression that we should think further about the term conjuncture and convergence, because it's kind of, to me at least, still not clear what, even if you made it very explicit, where you relate to and of which kind to empirical facts which you can bring together, how this convergence can be understood. So what is it in a changing hegemonic situation? What is labor market induced policy? What is gender related law development? We had very contradictory responses with regard to asylum right, on the one hand, and on the right to not be sexually violated in Germany. So the last one was pushed forward in a more feminist way. Feminists had been waiting for a long time that this comes true.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, we have a sharpened situation on the side of asylum seeker situation. So the contradictions between these convergences or converging discourses, I think, is still to be further developed, I should say. But yes, you cross the line coming from more culturalized arguments, from more economy-related questions. And yes, we should broaden the picture, because if you look to migrant women who don't have asylum status, what are they going to do? They work in prostitution. Of course, we don't want them, quotation marks. You know, so it's there's a great variety of different group-related ways of giving way to integration or not. So that was kind of not your topic, but I think that would something be to be further developed if we want to have the full picture of what's going on actually in the name of dealing with the problems, and be it demographic politics and the need of care work, but also on the other side, how people deal with the consequences of crisis-related cuts of fundings, as you mentioned. So I think there's place and space for further debates, but I see that you're tired now, and let's get together with a drink, and thank you very much,
thank
Sarah.
You.